The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning to you.
Morning.
And welcome to our service today, when we're going to begin by turning to hymn number 497. And we've been in the habit of singing quietly through our face masks in recent weeks. So let's sing together 497, just these two verses. Let all the world in every corner sing, My God and King. So we join together in our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are open, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us kneel and sit. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, The first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us then confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We stand and say together, Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you. We give you thanks. We praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Collect for this fifth Sunday after Trinity. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry they may serve you in holiness and truth, to the glory of your name. Through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we sit to hear our first reading. And St. Paul here speaks of the vision he had of himself, in effect. He writes somewhat obscurely, that talks about his thorn in the flesh.
The reading is taken from the second book of Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 2 to 10. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up into the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But I wish to boast. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I am speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one will think the better of me. What is seen in me and what is heard from me. Even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given to me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. Three times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell within me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, I am then strong.
And our second hymn is number 507, Lord of All Hopefulness. 507.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel is taken from St. Mark, chapter 6, beginning at the first verse. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus left there and went to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. Where did this man get these things, they asked. What's this wisdom that has been given him, that he even does miracles? Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, only in his hometown, among his relatives and in his own house, is a prophet without honor. He could not do any miracles there, except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. And he was amazed at their lack of faith. Then Jesus went round teaching from village to village. Calling the 12 to him, he sent them out two by two and gave them authority over evil spirits. These were his instructions. Take nothing for the journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in your belts. Wear sandals, but not an extra tunic. Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that town. And if any place will not welcome you or listen to you, shake the dust off your feet when you leave, as a testimony against them. They went out and preached that people should repent. They drove out many demons and anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Well, I wonder if you've ever had the experience when you're trying to tell someone you're close to something important and they just don't appear to be listening. I won't tell you how many times Michelle says to me that I'm just not listening. She's told me things. We often fail to pay attention, and particularly to those we know well. And our gospel today reminds us how people in Jesus' hometown of Nazareth also were failing to listen to him. They could not accept that this boy they had known as the carpenter's son could be at all important, that he said anything that was worth listening to. I expect we've all experienced that. Perhaps within our families when we were younger, the teenager not being taken seriously by their parents, and perhaps even within our own families today, others struggling to listen to our wisdom and accept the words of grace and love and encouragement we offer. We've been saying to our son James for months about considering signing up to a course in Kendal, and he's just said no, no, no. But his teacher suggested the same thing, and suddenly he's interested. So that's just life and families. But this was the experience for Jesus in his hometown. And so the people rejected him. They could not perceive that they could gain benefit or anything by listening to this man, a mere carpenter. It's interesting that Mark bothered to record this event in his gospel. Why bother to write it down? Surely it would undermine the case for Jesus being truly God's son. Let's gloss over that and not record that in the gospel. But perhaps it's there to illustrate how all of us have the capacity to reject Christ. It is a story about how we can ignore and reject God. It's a story about our unwillingness to be helped by God or by anybody else. An unwillingness which comes out of what we think are our own certainties, our own knowledge, our own strength. For the people who lived in Jesus' hometown, their knowledge of him as a youth prevented them from seeing God's power in him as an adult. For others today, the grace of God is shut out, not because they know Christ so well, but because they think they know what is best for themselves, and because they refuse to accept that perhaps they need help. Perhaps their understanding and their own strength is getting in the way. It's often true that the road to spiritual wholeness is not travelled by exercising our own human powers, but rather by acknowledging our human weaknesses, and then in that weakness, allowing God to exercise his power in us. This is why we read of St. Paul, who heard God say to him, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness." Paul had this affliction, this thorn in the flesh. We don't know exactly what it was, but it sounds like some kind of physical affliction. And three times he'd asked God to take it away, but with no success. And then came for Paul a point of acceptance. It was revealed to him that this sign of weakness could actually become strength. He felt God saying to him, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness." So he says, "I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me." To the world, this is nonsense. Power and strength are worshipped by most people, and weakness is despised above all things. The world teaches us to conceal our vulnerability, lest we be hurt, and it teaches us to hide our weakness, lest we be taken advantage of. The world teaches us to camouflage our inadequacies with self-confidence, self-reliance, and self-assurance, so that we can build a haven for ourselves here on earth. The world teaches that we can help ourselves, that we can do what we need to do on our own, and that all the answers we need we can find in ourselves. But we know in this that the world is wrong. If we try and live solely in our own strength, we find it to be an uphill battle. And sooner or later we come unstuck and life can unravel around us. We have to then admit our weakness, and in so doing fall back on God our Creator, our Heavenly Father. Our weaknesses, our hardships, and our tribulations are not of themselves a blessing, of course, but they can, when we acknowledge them and our needs, help us turn to God, help us ask for his help, instead of relying on solely our own skill and wisdom and strength to save us. And then something profound happens. We discover that God's grace is sufficient for us, that his power is made perfect in our weakness, and almost always in ways we do not expect. Our response to all this is then to acknowledge our weakness and to ask God to help us. The story is told about how one day a small boy was trying to lift a stone much too heavy for him. His father walked by and, seeing his struggles, said, "Are you using all your strength?" The boy said that indeed he was, but the father replied, "No, son, you aren't. You haven't asked me." How much have we not asked God about? How much of our weakness do we keep locked up inside us, because we think that there is no hope for us, or because we think that other things are more important? What do we need to acknowledge so that God can begin to use it and transform it? It's not an easy thing to do, but when we begin to own up to our weaknesses and address them, we can grow stronger and more rounded people as a result. It requires a deeper level of honesty that we might find comfortable. But the end results are that God is able to work through us even more effectively than we imagined. His power is made perfect in our weakness, for it is there that he is able to do for us what we, in our own strength, have not let him do. So what are your thorns in the flesh? How might you ask God to help you live with them and so be stronger as a result? And so we're going to turn to prayer, so let us pray. Within our prayers this morning, we continue to pray for the solutions to this pandemic and the way we can return to a more normal life. We give thanks today for the compassion we have discovered through the last year. Compassion for those who are struggling and ill. Compassion for our key workers and a recognition of their importance. We pray that we would not lose that sense of identification with those around us, that they would strengthen the bonds of community and fellowship. We pray today for our food banks, for those who find themselves in need of such help, those who have been made redundant, those who for a short time are without work and the income they need. Pray for your blessing, Father, on those who volunteer and work in the food banks across the country. And pray for those families as they acknowledge their vulnerability and weakness at this time and lean back on others for help. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who work in hospitality and especially across this county of Cumbria. For those places of hospitality that are struggling to survive. We pray for workers and those needed in employment in this industry. And as the lockdowns continue to ease, we pray for hospitality to be sustainable here in this county. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Pray too today for all our PCC treasurers across the Two Valleys team. We give thanks for their dedication week by week, month by month, in managing our church accounts, for the stresses that this brings and the worry. We pray that you would uphold them. So we pray especially for Janet today and for your blessing upon her. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are poorly at this time and in hospital. Pray for Anthony Clark today, recovering from surgery on his lung. Pray too for Bill Bennett, awaiting scans. For others known to us who are sick or suffering in body, mind or spirit. And remembering the recently bereaved, praying especially for the family of Fiona Sloss, whose funeral will take place this week in Crossways. We remember those who've gone before us and give thanks for them. And today, from our collective books of remembrance across our parishes, we remember especially Geraldine Braithwaite, Ellen Pierce, Harvey Nelson, Peter Barber, Colin Jackson, Elsie Rigby, Robert Ogden, Roland Edmonds, Jack Myers, and Margaret Darg, whose anniversaries all fall in this coming week. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And in a moment of stillness, we pray for ourselves. We pray that we may have the courage and the honesty to acknowledge our weaknesses, to recognise we cannot live in our own strength alone, to have that mustard seed of faith to turn to God for help. And may we find his power in our weaknesses. So we pray for this coming week in our own lives and in the life of this parish and across the two valleys. Father, may you pour your blessing upon us and our parishes. Give us all that we need to cope with life and its ups and downs. Where we are struggling, give us comfort and consolation, and strengthen our hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. If you'd like to stand, please. We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We offer one another a sign of peace. And so we turn to our third hymn, number 267, Thou whose almighty word chaos and darkness heard, let there be light. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God for bread. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. For he is your living word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born of woman and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us a people for your own possession. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember this offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Accept through him, our great High Priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. Let us kneel or sit as we continue in prayer with the words our Saviour taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, We are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we beseech thee, that the course of this world may be so peaceably ordered by your governance, that your church may joyfully serve you in all godly quietness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Our final hymn is number 435. Glorious things of thee are spoken. Next Sunday we have our usual 10 o'clock family service, but the Sunday after that, the 18th of July, we've got a special service at 11 o'clock just for that week to celebrate the 350th anniversary of this church. So we're putting together a special service for that and holding it at a slightly later time in the morning in the hope that others from the village will find it more easily to join us at that time. So 11 o'clock, Sunday the 18th, a fortnight from now. Do make a note of that, and the plans for the rest of the afternoon. to share afternoon tea over in the old vicarage garden as well. So commend that to you and encourage folk in Witherstack to come to that service at 11 o'clock on the 18th. Let's pray for God's blessing. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ.